Okay, well, thank you all for coming. So yes, my name is Julian Smith. I'm from a small company in Cambridge in the UK called Undo. And today I'm gonna be talking about next generation debugging. We've been doing some work on reversible debuggers in Undo, and I'd like to sort of share some of the sort of more researchy ideas that we're trying out in-house at the moment. But before I do that, I think I might just do a little bit of background on testing and debugging and the various things that you can do at the moment, just as a contrast with the more research-oriented information that I'll be talking about later. So I'll be talking about testing and then conventional debugging with things like GDB and things like that. And then at the end, Undo Research, we'll be talking about something called execution analysis and data flow analysis, which are two sort of research projects that we're doing at the moment. Actually, before I start, obviously, at any point, please ask questions. I'm very happy to answer questions at any time. So just a note about testing. We all know testing has changed in the last few years. There's so much more continuous integration, test-driven development, testing in the cloud. And this is fantastic. We're doing much better testing than we used to do. But there's a downside. We have thousands of tests running every hour, and we get lots of intermittent test failures, which are very difficult to fix. So this is a bit of a problem in the industry. And of course, when you get intermittent test failures that you can't quite solve, we all know the downside. You get security problems, you put your production outages, your users start complaining at you. It's not a nice place to be. So fixing a test failure is really hard. So typically, you might have to recreate a complex setup of computers that may be talking to each other, maybe lots of applications, networking, more than one machine. If you have a flaky test, that's a test that only sometimes fails. You might have to run it 10, 100, even 1,000 times before you get a failure. And that really, really makes debugging very difficult. For instance, if you're using printf debugging, you might have to recompile and link every time you make a change to add an extra diagnostic. And this is really slow and it's tedious and it makes the whole process rather unpleasant. So another problem, if you've got a test that takes a long time to run, again, if you have to reproduce it on your own machine and it doesn't reproduce the first time, you might have to run it again. If it only fails one time in 100, it can take all day just to get a single failure. So this is a rather large problem. So conventional tools, what have we got? Well, we have debuggers. We all know we can use logging. You can even do system logging, looking in the sort of more the depths of your operating system to find out a bit more information about what is going wrong. And of course, there's memory checkers like Vagrind. And a new thing in the last few years is to record the execution of a program. And if you record the execution, you can actually use a thing called reversible debugging. And maybe I should ask, how many of you are familiar with reversible debugging? Have you ever seen it? A few. Okay, maybe I'll give an example a little bit later just to sort of fill in other people. This talk is going to be mostly focused on Linux. I think as the future comes along, I think a lot of the things I'm going to be talking about will migrate to other operating systems, but for now, certainly our work is all Linux focused. Debuggers, most of you will have heard of GDB and a lot of you will have used it. It's got better in the last few years. I remember, 20 odd years ago, GDB was a pretty painful thing to use. It didn't work very well. It's got a lot better these days. Just as a simple example, it's almost a trivial example. If you run GDB on a examples on a program like this, Control X, Control A will show you source code, and you can step through. I mean, it's very trivial, but it's a useful thing to know about. GDB these days, it uses Python as an extension language, so you can actually program the debugger. And I'll be giving a couple of examples of that later on, which sometimes can be a very useful technique. Something that probably a lot of you already know, You can generate debug symbols even in optimized code. So GCC minus O2, you can still use the minus G flag. And it doesn't affect the code generation. The code's still as fast as it used to be. It just adds debug symbols. So you can do things like generate debug symbols, split them off into a separate file, give the stripped file to your customer. But then when you want to debug, tell GDB about the symbol file, and you get to debug your optimized code that your customer is using, which solves a few problems. One slightly weird thing that happens when you do that is that the compiler sometimes moves code around in ways you're not expecting. So when you step through code, you might look like you're going backwards, even though you're not. A few other little commands that I use all the time when I'm using things like GDB. You can use the backtrace command on all threads, find the backtrace of all threads. Run the same command on all threads, so you could print out the stack pointer of all the threads that are currently active. And there's various convenience variables that you can print out, the program counter, but various registers like AX, or even the exit code of your program if it is finished. Various other things. So GDB's lots of command line options. As I say, it's not too bad these days. It's quite powerful. So GDB supports Python as an extension language. And this can be quite useful. So the way you do this, you just say source and then a Python file name, and it will run that Python file and give it access to the GDB's own state. So I've got three examples here. If you have a program that only fails occasionally and you want to capture that failure in a debugger, you might press run, and it runs and finishes, and it doesn't go wrong. Press run again. And you might have to press run 10, 20, 100 times. Using Python, you can script that. So this little script here, it imports GDB, which is available as a module inside GDB. It loops forever, runs your program until the exit code is not zero. Slightly more complicated script here. Similarly, it runs until your program hits a breakpoint. And a little bit more complicated again, this version runs your program repeatedly until it gets a SIG-SEGV. So I'll give you a little example of one of those. Examples. Ah, hang on. There we go. So this is a program we were looking at. This is a program that fails only occasionally. It uses a random number to only fail maybe 1 out of 10 times. And if you run it, it failed that time. If I run it again, it didn't fail that time. So it's an intermittent program. If I do source repeat until non-zero exit, which is the little Python you saw just now. If I can find that for you. This is running this Python here. It will repeatedly run it. Failed first time again, but if it repeatedly run it until it fails. The moment it's passing. Eventually, I've got my fingers crossed, this will fail. Yeah, it's bad luck. It's giving a demo. Never. Oh, there we go. Yeah, there we go. It's failed. I'm quite relieved about that. Never use random numbers in a talk. It doesn't work. So that's just a useful technique. And of course, you can do a lot more than that. GDB gives all sorts of information to a Python extension. In fact, we use it all the time in our reversible debugger that sits on top of GDB. So you can get access to variables and debug symbols and all sorts of things. And I think it's almost like meta debugging. It's using a programming language to debug another program. At some point, presumably somebody will start debugging their Python extension to GDB using another meta level of complexity, but let's not go there. So another thing about Linux, again, 10, 20 years ago, the front ends for GDB, the graphical front ends, were quite frankly embarrassing. Anybody who used both Linux and Windows 10 years ago, there was just no comparison. Windows is much, much better graphical user interfaces. These days, Linux is catching up, I think. So there's several graphical front ends, GDB, CLI, Eclipse, Qt Creator. And they're getting pretty good. I don't use Windows myself, so I'm not quite sure what the state of play there is, but certainly I think Linux is getting a lot better at this sort of thing. And it's really important. One of the things about debugging is, we don't like to admit it, but we probably spend half of our time debugging our code. It's one of those things that we don't like to talk about, but we do spend all that time, and it's really important that our tools reflect that our tools are good enough to match the extent to which we spend our working life debugging. So just a little, if you like, a side alley here, I'm going to just talk about logging. And this is a slightly idiosyncratic sort of couple of slides, but just bear with me, it's a little bit fun. So often when you log, you need to control which logging is activated and which logging isn't. So often you have categories so that you can log to an I/O category or log to a serialization category, depending on what your code is doing. And I've always found that rather complicated. I don't know about you, but you define your categories and you have levels for different categories, and it can get quite confusing about what exactly is getting logged. And also, you might want to... Somebody defines your categories before you start your work, and if you're looking at a bug, the categories might not quite match what you're trying to debug. So you end up with either less debugging than you need, or less logging than you need, or... almost too much logging, lots of stuff that's not interesting. So it's sort of quite an inflexible sort of technique. For instance, if we have some code that writes serialized data to a file, what category is that? Is that I/O or is it serialization? It's sort of both. It depends on what you're doing. So logging categories is a little bit inflexible. And actually, one thing we do when we use logging in Undo, we use the program structure itself to define our logging categories. Code is already categorized. It's already in directories. It's already in source files and functions within those source files. So we use those directories and source files and function names as our implicit categories. So we don't have to define categories ourselves. We get different levels of categories, different subdirectories, things like that, all for free. And we even get nested categories. So the way this works is we say you can add a debug level for a source code path. So that's a directory called network and a subdirectory called socket. All source code within those directories will get extra diagnostics, one more than normal. Similarly, we could even add a top level thing. So code in the network directory gets an additional plus one. And then you can get even more detailed, where you can have extra diagnostics for heap/alloc.c and maybe network/socket.c as well. And even turn off or decrease the logging levels in your parser submodule. So this works quite nicely, and it means that you can control the verbosity very simply. So it's very, very nice for the QA department. They can just set an environmental variable. You don't need to recompile and link, obviously, as with all logging. So you can activate logging from different parts of your program, depending on the bug that you're looking at. An example of that is we have this environmental variable. And we set it to here, so you get extra logging in heap/alloc.c, less logging in the parser, and a lot more logging in the network/socket.c send function. So that's just a little bit of a diversion, but you might maybe want to try that yourself in your own code. So just before I get on to the really interesting stuff, just a little bit of background on strace and a couple of other tools. This is Linux specific, obviously. So some of you might have heard of strace. It's a way of logging all the system calls that your program executes. And it's a little bit crude, actually. It's a little bit, I like it like a lot of Unix. It's a very simple, crude tool. But it's actually quite powerful, and it's worth knowing, worth bearing in mind that this is available. So if you run strace on, say, the date executable, you get a list of all the system calls that the executable runs. So when it starts up, it does an exec, gets some memory, maps some memory, opens various libraries, closes things, and eventually at the end, it might even write out some information to the standard out, which is this write call, I think. So you can sort of see what a program has done just by looking at the system calls that it runs. And then you can tell it to tell strace to only output file-related information, file-related system calls. So this is all the file operations that it's doing. Or maybe run it with memory, so you only see the memory operations, so lots of mmap system calls here. It's a crude tool, but it's worth knowing about, because sometimes if you're on a machine that maybe doesn't have any developer support and you're looking at a problem, just knowing that things like strace are available is very useful. So that's quite a neat little tool. It's not perfect, and it only gives information on system calls, but still useful. And one very important thing, you don't need to recompile your application, which is pretty important. None of us like to recompile our program with different flags in order to run a debugger tool. That's no fun. Valgrind. How many people have heard of Valgrind here? Excellent. Good. It's one of my favorite tools. Fantastic. So it's available for, actually, I was surprised. I didn't realize it was available for OS X, also Solaris and Android. So you'll know, it's a fantastic tool, very detailed checking of the execution, similar to Purify, but it actually goes, it has all sorts of different submodules. So you can do memory checking for overwriting a stack, USAT3, all that sort of stuff, which is very useful. And it's got some astonishingly powerful thread checking modules as well, which can find data races and things like that. And there's things I haven't actually used very much myself, things that check for the CPU cache usage and things like that. So that's it's a fantastic tool, really recommended. Okay, so I'm going to move on to sort of new stuff now. And this whole idea of recording the execution of a program. This is kind of, in the last few years, this has become possible to do actually in practical work. There's been some academic work over decades, in fact, about recording a program and replaying it, but it hasn't been practical. Academia doesn't worry about being practical, it just does the theory. On Linux, there's our own live recorder product, which I'll be talking about a little bit. There's also a competing product called RR, which is kind of an interesting take on this. Windows sort of tries to do recording of execution, but it's only partial, I think, as far as I know. It doesn't really record everything. It only records function calls and a limited amount of information. But it's going in the right direction. On Java, there's Cronon is doing this, and actually with Undo, we are looking into doing that ourselves. It's quite complicated. What we're going to be doing is actually recording the JVM and then going backwards, making the JVM go backwards, and then patch up so that the user thinks their Java program has gone backwards. It's a sort of interesting sort of technical challenge. So our live recorder is a library. So you link it into your application, and it allows your application to record its own execution. And you get a little simple little C API to start and stop recording. So it's an API is in a header file and in the library. So, and what you get out is a file, an undo recording file. And that undo recording file contains the starting state of your program. And then it contains all what we call the non-deterministic input to the program. So it enables our debugger to replay the execution of your program, and so that it runs in exactly the same way as it did when it was being recorded. With Live Recorder, we also include the executable and all the shared library files and all the debug files as well. So you get this single file that contains everything that's needed to replay the execution of the original program. So it's kind of a powerful sort of system. And in particular, you can debug something even when you might take a recording from somebody else's machine, put it on your machine, and you can replay on your machine, even if you haven't got the libraries that were used originally on the user's machine. So everything required is packaged in the recording file. So it's kind of a powerful system. And you use our debugger front end to GDB to load a recording. And the extra benefit is you get reversible debugging, which I'll maybe show you in a couple of minutes. Here's the API. We try and keep it simple. You start recording, stop recording, save a recording to a file. Stop and save is slightly slightly complicated. Save on termination means that however your program exits, whether it returns or whether it crashes, we'll save the recording, and that's a useful thing if you're running a test case, for instance. So we use it you can use it in internal testing, and also you can use it at a customer site. So the idea here is that you put it into your program, give it to your customer. If a customer has a problem, they click on a button and it'll activate recording, and then they can send a recording back to you, and then you can debug what's happening on the customer site on your developer's machine, which is kind of cool. A big advantage is you can debug using reversible debugging, which I'll be showing. You and the customer control when and if you record or not. And you don't have to worry about the setup on your customer's machine or the setup in the QA department. If they're using a strange libc that you don't have, when you replay, the replay will use that strange libc. It won't use your libc. So you're replaying exactly what happened. Another rather nice thing is that you can give this recording to multiple developers, and you can all look at the same bug together. Use concurrency to solve the problem. Another little bit of fun, really. We have this function, save on termination. There's also save on termination cancel. So just what you can do is save a recording only if something went wrong. So in main, we can start recording, and we'll tell it to save on termination. Then if we exit normally, we'll just say save on termination cancel, and it won't save a recording. But any other exit without calling save on termination cancel will create a recording. So that's a rather nice little trick, especially useful in QA if you're testing. So I'll just give a small demonstration of how this all works together. I've got a little program with a deliberate bug in it, which I won't talk that much about here. And what I've done, this program on the code on the left is the program with the bug in it, and on the right we've annotated it. We added some extra live recorder source code. So we included the header file here, and then down here we call recording start, and then we say save on termination. And if we were to return zero, we would say save on termination cancel. So the idea is that if we get a problem, it'll save a recording. So I built this, and if we run it, this program will run. It's gone wrong. You see a little bit of a delay there. That was it saving the recording file. And if we look in the current directory, this file here is the recording that we've just created. And we can load that into a debugger, a reversible debugger. So this is using a KDBG front end to GDB, but using it with Undo's debugger. So it's a fairly standard, little simple, standalone debugger. So when the recording was started, we were actually in recording start. That's when recording was started. If I continue execution, we end up in this assert, because the program went wrong. One thing to bear in mind here, I'll just move this window out of the way. This is the output from this replay, if you like. Now, you'll notice there's no output there. That's because the program is not running for real. We're not actually running the program here. We're replaying the original execution. So the debugger thinks it's running a real program, but actually it's not. It's replaying. So there's no output. There's no system calls being run here. So what we can do with a reversible debugger, we can set a breakpoint, and we can go back to that breakpoint using reverse continue. That's not too different from a normal debugger. Normal debuggers, you can look up the stack, as we all know. But we can do something that you can't do in a normal debugger. We can actually reverse step over, and we can go backwards. Okay. This is kind of powerful. This is using a reversible debugger to look at something that happened potentially on a different machine, on a customer site on the other side of the world, replaying exactly what went on there. And this program's got a deliberate bug. And I'm going to, maybe I'll spend just a couple of minutes just going through this demo just to give you a flavor of what's going on. So this program is trying to test this cache calculate function with return square root. And it's trying to assert whether the square root return from cache calculate is the correct square root. And they were different. And so that's why it hit the assert. So the number we tried to find the square root of is 255. Unfortunately, square root cache from cache calculate was 0. Square root correct is 13, but that's actually because it hasn't been initialized yet. If I step forwards, you see it's so the correct square root in integer terms is 15. And that's why the assert failed. What we can do, we can step backwards, and now we can step into cache calculate and try and figure out why did it return 0, because it should have returned 15. So if I do reverse step into, that'll take us to the end of cache calculate, which is up here. And we can step backwards. And again. And what's happened is we've found this number in our little cache of square root, number to square root mappings. It's cache element, if I hover over there, cache element 90. Cache element 90 says the square root of 255 is 0. Well, that's wrong. Our cache has been calculated, has been corrupted. And you can imagine with a normal debugger, we're a bit stuck here. We don't know who corrupted that cache entry. It happened sometime in the past. This is a horrible sort of bug to fix. But what we can do, and some of you might have seen our demo actually when we were talking about this, we're going to set a watch point on cache element 90. How many people know what a watch point is? Yeah, excellent, good. Watch points, they're pretty rubbish normally. When you can go backwards, they're really powerful. So we've set a watch point on cache element 90, and we're going to do reverse continue, and that'll take us back to the last time somebody wrote to cache element number 90. So that's a previous call, an earlier call to cache calculate. You'll notice cache 90 now contains 40 and 6, which is correct. But if we step forward one line, it now contains 255 and 6. We step again, it contains 255 and 0. So we've got to be able to go to the exact point at which the cache is corrupted. So this is really powerful. This is reversible debugging. It's a great thing. Maybe I'll just explain. The reason it's gone wrong is we're trying to calculate the square root of minus 1. Oh, there's a question.
To get my record on the disk.
So what's the impact on execution time? It sort of depends. We normally reckon a slowdown when you're recording of between 2 and 5 times. Sometimes up to 10 if you're unlucky, depending on what your program is doing. So something like that. We've got various plans to work on that, to reduce that. So we're hoping to get that down, possibly even to 1.5 times, between 1.5 and 2, depending on what your program is doing. Under the hood, it's what we're doing. We have a binary translator that looks at the individual instructions in your program and sort of translates them, a bit like what Valgrind does, actually. As you can imagine, that's quite hard, but we are... There's various techniques that we use to cache various things and optimize our versions of the code. So that's the sort of slowdown we're looking at.
Thank you.
And the recording size is an interesting one. Essentially, what we do, computers are normally deterministic. If you've got two numbers and you add them together, you always get the same result. But if you do a system call or a signal comes in or something like that, we call that non-deterministic. If you read from a socket, for instance, you're going to get different data each time. So we record the data that was read from the socket the first time around. We record the effects of all system calls. So that governs the size of the recording, all that data. So there's no easy... It depends on how much data your program reads from the environment. That determines the size of the recording. Okay. Questions. Well, I had a question. Thank you. If anybody else has a question, then feel free.
um,
What would it take for you to support Windows and Mac, or other platforms for that matter?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. When we started out, we started about 11 years ago, I think, myself and Greg Law, the other founder. Our plan at that point was to do a Linux version, because that's what we knew. We were Linux programmers. And then get some funding and do a Windows version, because that's where the money is. It hasn't worked out like that, partly because we don't know anything about Windows and have never met anybody who knows enough about the details of Windows. Partly also because Linux is sort of taken off in the last decade. You know, there's more than enough work and commercial opportunities for us just in the Linux world, so we haven't had to move into Windows. The way you do it in Windows or Mac, we have to know exactly what every single system call does. We have to know what memory it writes to and what memory it reads from for every system call. So for Linux, it's a hard problem, but it's a dual problem. Linux has a few hundred system calls. They're all fairly well documented. If they're not documented very well, you can look at the source code in the kernel, and that tells you exactly what the system call does. So it's solved. You can do it on Linux. For Windows and Mac, we'd have to have the same information. We'd almost certainly have to have access to the kernel source code. And that, for Windows, I suspect that's unlikely. I can't see that happening anytime soon. Perhaps for Mac. I don't know much about Mac. I'll say it uses the Mac kernel, I think. I don't know the details of that. Presumably there's some system call layer there as well. I don't know. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks. Is it pluggable into other IDEs, or do you have to use the KDBG?
No, other IDEs can be used as well. Our debugger, it normally comes in the form of it looks like GDB. It's actually it wraps GDB, but looks like GDB. So Eclipse and C-Line, we have a plugin for C-Line.
KDevelop?
I don't think we've got a patch for KDevelop at the moment. Mm-hmm. But it would be possible, because I think KDevelop uses GDB, so it's fairly easy.
Okay, it's still early in the morning, so I apologize if I missed the point. but the question is, why are you better than GDB's record functionality?
GDB? Ah, we're faster, is the basic answer.
How much?
So GDB, when it's recording, we've seen slowdowns of tens of thousands of times, 50,000 times slowdown, because it reverses individual CPU instructions, which is incredibly slow, because the instructions are tiny things. We only need to record non-deterministic behavior. We don't need to record deterministic behavior. So I haven't got a slide here, but there's a slide we sometimes talk about, and we did an experiment with gzip, and gzip zipped a 16 megabyte file in, I don't know, 1.5 seconds. With UndoDB, it took 3 seconds or something like that, 3 or 4 seconds. It was twice as slow. With process record, the GDB process record, I think it took 23 hours, and it used 60 gigabytes of memory. So it's unfortunate, but it's just not a practical tool, unfortunately.
And do you support various architectures, not only x86?
Yes, we have 32 and 64-bit x86, and we also support 32 and 64-bit ARM.
You probably investigated RR. How does it compare to your product, and what would be the main differences in choosing between them?
Yeah, RR is interesting. It does some of similar to what we do. The big difference in how it's implemented is it doesn't use binary translation. It uses performance counters to measure time. Actually, that gives a speed advantage. But the disadvantage is you can't handle shared memory. That's the big thing. To handle shared memory, you have to be able to get control of individual instructions and record what values they've read from the shared memory, because shared memory is an external input. It's something that you don't have control over, and other programs can modify it. So without instrumenting the binary, you can't do shared memory. It's a lot newer as well, so it hasn't had quite a lot as much work as we've done. Okay, thank you. I think, how are we doing? Not too bad. So now I'd like to move on to this sort of more researchy stuff that we're looking at, which is kind of interesting, I think. I hope you find it interesting. So the point here, traditional debugging, you only have partial information, and this is one of the reasons why it's so hard. If you have a core file, you have the program state at the end of its execution, and that's all you've got. With a traditional debugger, you can't go back to earlier state of your program. So you can only look at the current state. Even with Valgrind, which is a fantastic sort of program, you have to know in advance what sort of error is going to happen and choose the appropriate sort of engine. So if you're looking at cache usage, you'll use cache grind, memories, overwriting bugs, you have to use a memcheck module. And then the other one, I think, call grind, hell grind is a sort of thread related. So you have to know in advance what sort of bug is going to happen. And sometimes you do, and that's fine. But what happens if you're running with hell grind and you encounter some weird memory error? You're a bit stuck at that point. You have to rerun with memcheck, and then that takes time, and your program might not fail every time, and maybe the next time you run it, it'll have a thread bug. It's a slightly unfortunate state of affairs. One of the things we talk about with reversible debugging is you can go back in time. With this sort of debugging, you almost have to look forward in time. You have to predict the future in order to work out what tool to use. And that's unfortunate. Also, Valgrind is doing really complicated things. The same goes for things like Purify. It's analyzing all sorts of detailed things. So it runs pretty slowly. That's kind of a problem. Similarly, if you're using logging, it only shows you only get information from the logging that you have enabled. Again, you have to predict the future in order to work out what logging to enable. And we all know, normally, it's not the logging you actually needed to fix the bug that happened. It's just a real problem. So you might rerun your program with different logging, and then you just hope your bug isn't too intermittent, because it might not work the next time. So it's a slight, debugging is hard, and this is one of this lack of information is one of the main reasons it's hard. One of the nice things about an undo recording, and to an extent the RR recordings as well, they give you 100% knowledge of what your program did. Now here's a sort of little toy proof of that. If you're loaded a recording of your program's execution, you can step I instruction, and you could use step I time repeatedly, and it would give you the entire state of the program at every point of its execution. You might have to enter step I a billion times or 100 billion times, but all the information is actually there. You can find it out. So this is quite remarkable. You don't get this very often in any field, really. You have 100% of the information that you need to solve a problem. And once you've gone a billion step I's forward, you can go a billion step I's back. So you can get to any point in the execution, look at and all the memory has been reproduced exactly at that point in time, and all the registers. So, 100% knowledge, that's pretty good. The other thing about this is that because undo, when we're recording the execution, we're not actually analyzing anything. We're just recording the smallest amount of information that we need to be able to replay later on. It's a lot faster than Valgrind, which is kind of cool. So the problem becomes, rather than trying to find and understand a bug using incomplete information, with a much smaller problem, but it's still a problem, which is how do we navigate this information in order to find out what happened? And there's various things. We've got go-to time. We can jump around in the time of the execution. And as you saw, we've got reverse next and reverse step and things like that. So we can jump around in the execution. There's all sorts of rather cool things we can do. And we set a watch point. You saw we had a watch point before. That's a really powerful feature as well. There's various really powerful things we have to navigate this execution recording that we have. We can even look at events, the non-deterministic inputs to the program we call events. And you can go to the previous read system call or the previous mmap system call, or you can go to the the previous read system call that failed. You can jump around in the execution like that. That's great. But even these quite powerful new features of reversible debugging, they're not always quite enough to track down the really, really difficult bugs. So the problem is, you know, we've got all this information. We're trying to work out better ways of giving the user access to this information to help them find and fix bugs. So here's some of the things that we are thinking about in Undo. How can we make better use of this 100% complete knowledge? So one idea, well, we can replay, but gather extra information. So maybe we could output extra diagnostics when we replay the execution. Some of you might have seen GDB's breakpoint commands. You can set a breakpoint in GDB and associate a command with that breakpoint that prints some information. So whenever you hit that breakpoint, it'll print out, say, a variable value, and then it'll carry on. So you get a sort of a log of output from the debugger whenever you run. So we're thinking about sort of doing a sort of cleverer version of that, where we're not changing the replay, the execution of the program, but we're annotating it and giving extra output. So that's one way of doing it. We might also think about doing, sort of Valgrind style annotations of an analysis of the execution of the program. So this is kind of really interesting, because what this means is that you could run your program on under Undo, get a recording, and then replay that recording using Memcheck, and then replay again using Hellgrind. And so you're actually using your different debugging techniques can be applied to the same execution. So if you've got an intermittent bug that happens one time in 1,000, if you've captured it using a recording, you've got a recording of that bug, you can then analyze it in different ways at your leisure. And that's really powerful. That's something that's never been possible before. Now, it just requires us to implement Memcheck and Hellgrind within Undo, which is, you know, a fairly significant project. But that's, once we've done that, you know, the power here could be quite extraordinary. And on more sort of simple things, we could log all calls to a particular set of functions. You could navigate backwards and forwards to look at when functions are called. Log all the locks of a particular mutex, or navigate to the next time a particular mutex was locked or unlocked. There's all sorts of various things that, you know, potentially we could do here. And again, we're trying to make it so that we're trying to give better access to this 100% complete knowledge that we have in a recording. That's the whole motivation here. So you might have some ideas yourself, and you know what would be useful in the latest bug you're looking at. If you had a recording of the execution, what would you like to know about that execution? You know, have a think, and if you've got any ideas, let me know and get in touch, because this is new stuff, and we know quite a lot about reversible debugging, but we don't know about your program. So you might have some really interesting debugging ideas, really interesting ideas about what would help you solve your particular problems. So what I'd like to end up at some point, and this is a bit of a pipe dream, but this is an algorithm to find a bug. You get a recording of the execution. You use forwards, reverse commands, watch points, break points, whatever you want to try and find that information. If you haven't figured it out, replay again with different annotations, with some Valgrind checking or some other thing. Maybe we'll even give you programmatic access to our replay engine, so that you can actually write your own Valgrind-style annotation machinery. Replay again with that, and that'll give you more information, and repeat until you figured out the bug. So solving a bug, I think we should be getting away from this sort of thinking hard and trying to guess what's going on, and a more algorithmic way, if you like, of approaching bug fixing, where we actually, you know, we know how to program computers in this room. We're all good at it. I'd like us to be able to use that ability to actually program our debugging experience. So I think that's kind of an interesting future for debugging, if you like. And the bottom line here, if you have a recording, it must be possible to figure out a bug. You know, there's 100% knowledge there. If you can't figure it out, it just means you haven't written the annotations or the analysis that's capable of figuring it out for you. So just a sort of summary of all some of these things we've been talking about. When you're using a recording sort of approach, you have a constant modest speed overhead. So it's much faster than doing Valgrind-style detailed analysis at runtime. In the future, when we've worked on all this stuff, you'll only incur a large analysis overhead only when required. One rather interesting thing here, for some of you who might work in the financial industry, one thing we're looking at, you could run a program today, save a recording, and then in 6 months' time, when the WTO or something changes their regulations and is accusing you of doing something bad, you can analyze that old recording and prove to them, no, you weren't doing anything bad, because you've got this recording and you can tell them exactly what it was doing. So it doesn't rely on you predicting the future. You don't have to know today what information some regulatory body is going to ask you about the execution of your program. Any questions there? I've got one more section. Yeah, at the back.
When you do the recording, that must have some impact on a thread.
Yes.
When the thread is switched in and out. So, yes. So some bugs are dependent of awkward thread switching time. How yes. do you deal with that?
So at the moment, we serialize threads. So essentially, it looks like you're running your program on a single core CPU. And then we record when the thread switches happen so that we replay the thread switches. That can hide certain subtle race conditions.
Okay, so then you solve the bug by turning on the recording.
Sorry?
So then you solve the bug by turning on the recording and keep it on.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, and actually one of our sort of...
That's the same with logging. Sometimes the bug disappears when you turn on logging.
Yes, it can be a problem. I mean, we're looking at... I'm not allowed to say very much about this, but we are looking at that. And so at some point, that won't be a problem.
Hi, you mentioned about the things that you would like to see, you know, when we debug things. One thing that I'm regular debugging, what I like to do is just changing the value of a variable to see what happens. I mean, of course, if you do that, you can't go backwards anymore, but it would be really cool if at least you could go forwards again. Is that something you're looking at?
Yes, we get asked about that quite often. Changing history is a bit tricky. yeah, you could... yeah. So if you're under our interactive debugger, you're in what we call record mode the first time you run through, you can change registers and memory and carry on running. Going back and changing the value and then carry on running is theoretically dubious. the reason is if you change something and then you replay what happened later on, you might change the pattern of what your program does. So it might not do a system call that you did before, or it might do an extra system call. And then if it reads from a socket, maybe it didn't read that first time around. So what do we do? Do we actually, that socket no longer exists because we're back. In some limited cases, you might be able to do that. If there's no interaction with the outside world, then yes, changing history is certainly an option. And actually, at that point, the difficulty is actually probably more a difficulty of the user interface rather than actually implementing it, because it's going to get ever so confusing. So yeah, we do think about that, and it's a tricky one. Yeah.
Could you elaborate a little bit more on shared memory? Because I use shared memory a lot, and obviously everything that happens in shared memory by an outside process is completely non-deterministic.
Yeah.
So that would require recording everything that happens in shared memory, but you don't even know that it's happening because it's happening in another process. So how do you tackle...
So the way we do that is whenever you read from shared memory, we record the value that you read. If that value is the same as the most recent value you read from the same address, we don't bother saving it. So in pathological cases, if you've got some shared memory which is changing all the time and you're reading it all the time, then our event logs is going to fill up very quickly. In practice, you know, we have customers with enormous programs using massive, you know, I think we have a customer with a terabyte of RAM and 1,000 cores. It's just ridiculous. And they use shared memory, but in practice, people don't generally use shared memory for transferring large amounts of information that's dynamically changing all the time. So we don't run into the pathological case in practice. Is that, yeah?
I saw you talked about the the Valgrind integration, the memory-like checks. But do you plan to integrate the sanitizers-like checks from Clang? If the sanitizers, I will not say that they are better than Valgrind, but they are definitely much faster.
Oh, really? Oh, that's interesting. When I was talking about that, I don't think it's possible, at least not trivially, to actually embed things like Valgrind into our engine. We'd have to replicate, we'd have to copy what they do. Otherwise, what you'll end up doing is debugging the Valgrind engine rather than, or the Valgrind will be debugging our engine depending on which gets control first. So we'd have to re-implement things like Hellgrind and, and maybe the examples you gave. Yeah. So, one more question. How are we doing?
What is with debugging on remote machines? So recording on a remote machine, and then is this recommended to run the recording on the same machine, or can I run it on another machine?
You can run it on any machine. As long as the machine has the same CPU, at least supports the same CPU features.
Ah, okay.
Yeah. I don't think, I think if it's an Intel CPU, I think you have to replan an Intel CPU that's at least as advanced. I think it wouldn't work Intel to AMD or the other way around. But we don't care about the operating system. So you could record on a CentOS 5 machine and replay on an Ubuntu 14.06, for instance.
We are dealing with cross-compiling. Is there a possibility to do that?
We don't care where the binary came from. We look at the machine code. So we don't mind how you created that machine code. Yeah. We leave the overlying debugger to worry about source code symbols and things like that. We just deal with machine code. So it's not a problem for us. Okay, so maybe if I just finish off, this is another particular form of execution analysis, which we call data flow analysis. So this is, again, internal research and development. It's not available yet, and when it is available, it might be different from what you're seeing here. So just one interesting point here. When you're debugging, you're often focusing on function calls. You're looking at functions in a stack. You're stepping forwards and backwards using step, step I, next I, finish, that sort of thing, and stepping backwards with the reverse equivalents. And you can, with a reversible debugger, you go backwards and forwards with continue and reverse continue. Breakpoints and watch points come in as well. And then having moved backwards and forwards, we look at registers and local variables and global variables. So it's kind of how debugging works. What we're looking at is, can we look more generally at data rather than time? So for instance, the current CPU instruction, what inputs is it using and where do these inputs come from? So we have this sort of internal, rather long instruction command, GDB command, called current instruction info, and it shows the inputs and outputs of the current instruction. So it tells you that this instruction here is reading from this memory location, 4 bytes, and it's reading from register AX, and it's writing to register AX, because it's subtracting something from a register. One question this brings up is, where do these inputs come from? What's the value at this memory location, and where did it come from? Well, that's easy. We can set a watch point on this address and run backwards, and that'll tell us the bit of code that set that memory location. That's sort of conventional reversible debugging, if you like. It's good. But it also, the output of this instruction also depends on the value of the register AX. So to figure out, where did the original value of AX come from? What we want to do is be able to set a watch point, if you like, on the register AX. But you can't do that. Watch points only work on memory. CPU hardware doesn't have a concept of a watch point on a register. But undo, we can do everything. So we can make undo specially instrument code so we can actually look at registers and implement register watch points. So we can search backwards for reads and writes of registers using this new command here. So this goes back to the most recent instruction that either read AX or read register BP or wrote to register DS. So this is only possible because we have a recording. It's also only possible because we're instrumenting the binary of the code. So yeah, we're looking at individual instructions and we can do anything we like. It's only possible if we can modify vplay to track changes to registers. So luckily, undo's got this sort of technology, so we can actually do this sort of stuff. So to put this together, we can look at what register and memory is used by the current instruction. We can go back to the most recent time those registers or that memory was changed. Okay, so if the current instruction reads a memory location, set a watch point, go back. Great, I'll tell us where that memory location was set. If the current instruction reads one register, we can use underdb search registers, and that'll go back to the most recent time that that register was set, so we've figured out where the data's come from. But what if the current instruction is a bit more complicated? What if it reads more than one register? Lots of instructions do. They might add two registers together. Or maybe it reads a register and memory, like that example does. It's also in theory, I don't know whether any instructions do, but some instructions may read from more than one location in memory. The problem here is that the flow of data in your program is not a linear flow, it's a tree. It's a sort of bifurcating tree. Okay, so we've got a way of looking at this. What we're gonna do, this data flow tree, this flow of data as time goes on through your program, we're gonna explore this tree one step at a time. At each step, we'll either use a memory watch point or this new search registers command. We're going to remember the results of each step, and we do a breadth first search, so we look at the most recent changes first. And we have this sort of, again, rather clumsy long commands, where we start exploring data flow, and we use explore next to get each node in the tree one by one. And the end result's pretty impenetrable, actually. But you can take this information about where data is coming from, and you can turn it into a little picture. And I'll make that a bit smaller so you can see it. So in this picture, time is going upwards. So what this is saying, and it's a little bit confusing, but bear with me, maybe it'll make more sense if I try and talk about it. This number here, 316042, is a measure of time. That number there is the PC, the program counter value. So what this is saying is this instruction at this time read this memory address. And this memory address here, this word, the 4 bytes here, were most recently modified by this instruction at this slightly earlier time at this program counter value. Okay, so we've followed one step back in the data flow. And this instruction at this time, it read from this memory location, and it also read from register AX. So this could be the instruction we saw earlier. So this memory location was most recently set by this instruction at this even earlier time, and the AX register was most recently modified by this instruction at this earlier time as well. Okay, so we're stepping backwards, and we're following this sort of this tree of data flow backwards through the code. This is kind of cool. I hope it makes some sense to you. You can sort of see how it's sort of coming together. It's in development, so it's all a little bit crude at the moment. So essentially what we're doing, we're following data. Rather than looking at the program counter, the functions that are getting called, we're actually looking at data flow, which is a rather interesting way of looking at the flow of a program. So ultimately, we could find the ultimate root cause of some incorrect data. Sometimes you get a rather nasty bug where something's incorrect and you follow it back using a watch point and you get this here and it doesn't actually tell you exactly what's going on. It just means you want to go further back to find out actually where this data came from. It might be a read of from a file somewhere that had a value you weren't expecting. And, you know, 10 steps later on in your program, it calls something to SegV. This sort of technique allows you to find and fix that sort of bug and actually understand it. And maybe even you could even do test case synthesis. So you could deliberately run your program, trace the data flow, and then rerun it with slightly different inputs in order to provoke certain specific behavior that you want to test for. It's a little bit limited at the moment. We only handle reads and writes to general purpose registers, not the special registers that some CPUs provide. There's a few little niggles as well about if you're looking reading writing on the stack, does that really depend on the value of the stack pointer? Well, in theory it does, but in practice it probably isn't important. So there's a few issues like that. But it's quite an exciting sort of thing that you can't do unless you have a reversible debugger. If you try and trace data flow you can do using forwards only, the combinatorics just rapidly get out of hand because you have to store everything just in case the user wants to find a particular data flow later on. But if you can go backwards, you don't have to store everything. You can just uncover the data flow graph one node at a time as required by the user. So it's kind of exciting. We're going to be working on the speed. It takes quite a long time to develop that graph. I think that took about 20 seconds. So it's not practical yet. But it's kind of interesting, and it's one of those sort of little researchy things that maybe we'll have more, make more practical maybe in a year or two's time and get it released. Okay, I think that's all I have to talk about. If anybody's got any questions, that'll be a good time. Any good questions? Okay, great. Well, thank you for listening.